While we wait for you, surely We pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
You give life, singer.
You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Sing to him, church.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Sing, great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Sing. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. Your breath in our lungs. is to you only. We pour out our praise to you only.
Hello, church. Thanks for tuning in and worshiping the Lord with us together online. We are continuing on our series, Through Christ in the Old Testament. So my hope, as we've been going over this for the last several weeks, that these connections between Christ being pattern, promise, or present are helping you see the connectivity of the Bible, how you see how God is really orchestrating one story, one purpose throughout all these times, throughout all these people, throughout all these events, that all these things are leading up to the culmination, this amazing moment where Christ enters into human history to be the Savior, to be the Messiah, to be the Passover Lamb, to be the one lifted up, to be the one to take our place, to be the one to shed his blood, to be the one to be resurrected for us, to be the firstborn of the resurrected, to give us hope and means to be saved by God. Now, as we've been going through, obviously, there's a lot of verses, a lot of people, a lot of events that we've looked at. And it's my hope that as we've gone through this, it's kind of like a movie or a book. You might understand the bits and pieces as you're slowly going along, but it's not till the end where everything, all the loose ends are connected, tied together, that you see, okay, well, wow, okay, now I really see how maybe this event and that event, though seemingly unconnected, now when we look back, once again, hindsight is 20/20, we see how all these things are interconnected. And it's honestly what happened to the disciples, right? We started this series following our Easter message, looking at the Jesus revealing himself in resurrected form to two of his disciples who were on their way back to Emmaus. And it says, as they walked on that journey, Jesus opened up the Old Testament, proving that he was the Messiah. Then right after that event, Jesus appears to the 11 disciples, and he says this in Luke 24:44. It says, he said to them, being Jesus, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled, right? So that's what we've used as our kind of our launching pad to look at these categories, right? To look at the law of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the prophets, and the Psalms. And so we're going to look at the prophets in the next 2 weeks. And so today I want to have us camp out a little bit on the Psalms. Now, the Psalms are a collection of 150 songs or hymns or poems written throughout a wide authors through a wide period of time. And not all 150 are going to be quoted or directly referenced in the New Testament to point us to Christ, but there are quite a few. And so, once again, to save time and not do an exhaustive study on this, we are going to just start looking at a few kind of sections of Jesus' life and a few of these Psalms referenced here. It's my hope that, once again, you can see how these Psalms and the life of Christ are interconnected. A quick survey says that in the Gospels alone, the Psalms are referenced 10 times in Matthew, 9 times in John, 5 times in Luke, and 4 times in Mark, right? So Jesus spoke and referenced the Psalms quite a bit. But also there's other people referencing the Psalms in accordance to Jesus as well. So that's going to be the first one we look at. And we're going to start with the birth of Jesus. So in Luke's account, in Luke 1, verses 69, we see this man, Zechariah. He approaches Mary and Joseph as they're at the temple, and he was given a promise by God, a promise that he would not die before he got to see the Messiah. So this is what he says. This is part of his prophecy or his prayer, his praise to God, and he is going to quote a psalm. So this is what he says, Luke 1:69. And he raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. And that's Psalm 132:17. Once again, it's a beautiful picture here that this man has been waiting for this Messiah along with a whole host of the people of Israel for at least the last 1,000 years, waiting for Christ to come, knowing that he was going to come from the line of David. Now, when Zechariah is able to experience, to be able to see this blessing from God, to see the Messiah, he quotes scripture, right? He quotes back God's own promise made thousands of years, or at least hundreds of years before this event happened, as a prayer, as a praise to God, right? This is hopefully the overarching kind of things, our takeaway as we look through the Psalms, is that we see that God is in control. And I know we talked about this previously, but one of the things that can really help you, maybe if you're struggling with what to pray or how to pray, is follow Zechariah's example here. Use the scriptures themselves to pray back to God. And so, once again, there's a great book by Donald Whitney on that. I highly encourage you. But once again, we see this patterned in scripture. We see this patterned here with Zechariah to use the Bible itself in our prayers back to God. So that's our first point. We'll stop here and we'll go into a few other sections moving forward. But we see even at his birth, Zechariah is using a psalm to reference the beauty of Christ coming and the prophecy that he's fulfilling. All right, we see how Zechariah used the Psalms at Jesus' birth. The next section we're going to look at is the majority of Jesus' life, or the rest of his kind of earthly ministry. And so after his baptism, we are told that he goes into the desert. And now, once again, this isn't Jesus using the Psalms. The next example we have is Satan using the Psalms, but twisting it against Jesus. So in Luke 4:10, it is said this, "For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you," right? In Satan's temptation of Jesus, trying to get him to use his abilities, to get him to try to worship Satan rather than be obedient to the Father himself, Satan is twisting scripture, and he's twisting Psalm 91. And Jesus, once again, counters with scripture against Satan. So we see scripture being used well by Zechariah. We see scripture being used improperly by Satan. And then we see Jesus using scripture again to properly rebuff Satan's misuse of Psalm 91. Then, now getting to Jesus' own use, Jesus references the Psalms in his own teaching. And so when he teaches in parables in Matthew 13, 34, and 35, we read this, "All these things Jesus said to the crowds in parables. Indeed, he said nothing to them without a parable. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter what has been hidden since the foundation of the world." And that's a reference to Psalm 78:2. So even though it says, you know, by what the prophet has written, this is what a prophet wrote in the Psalms. And so, once again, it's found in Psalm 78:2. And then in Jesus' teaching on the Sermon on the Mount, his longest set sermon that we have recorded in the Gospels, you may know it starts with the Beatitudes. And one of those is even a direct reference to the Psalm. So in Matthew 5:5, Jesus says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." And that's a reference from Psalm 37, verses 11 and 29. So once again, Jesus is using the Psalms here in a support of his own teaching, right? That he is fulfilling these things in everything that he is saying, or at least in these references here. Now, some of the more commonly known reference to Christ in the Psalms might be from Psalm 22. So this is now Jesus dying on the cross. And as he's in pain and agony, he says this, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And that's a direct quote from Psalm 22, verse 1. And then it continues on, "Why are you so far from saving me and from my words of my groaning," right? And so, once again, Jesus is dying on the cross and he's starting off this psalm. Now, he might have said more and we're just given this short bit. He might have been only able to utter this first starting verse. But everyone around the cross would reference this and know exactly what Jesus was talking about. We often do this in our society as well. If I was to say, "I pledge allegiance to the flag," in your mind, you'd be continuing going on with the Pledge of Allegiance, right? Even if I just give that first sentence, you know what the rest of that reference is supposed to be. And so we see that same thing being patterned here by Jesus. Also, when Jesus was on the cross, one of the last things he said was a direct quote from Psalm 31:5, which says this, "Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God." And that's referenced in Matthew 27:46, as well as Luke 23:46. So we see, once again, Jesus using these psalms as he's dying on the cross to get people to see, look, I am fulfilling these scriptures. The last thing is more of a reference of what was done to Jesus. So in John 19:36, as John is describing the death of Christ on the cross, he says this, "For these things took place, that the scripture might be fulfilled, that not one of his bones will be broken." And that's a direct quote from Psalm 34:20, that none of the bones will be broken. Now, if you can recall from the crucifixion, the other two criminals had their legs broken to expedite the death sentence on them because night was drawing near. But when the guards went to see Jesus, he realized he had already died. He already committed his spirit to the Lord. We saw that from reference from Psalm 31:5. And so there's no need to break Jesus' legs. They pierced his side with the spear, and the blood and the water came out, proving that he was dead. So John ties all this together for us, saying, look, this even happened. His legs not being broken is a fulfillment of Psalm 34. Once again, hindsight's helping, plus with the power of the Holy Spirit, is helping the disciples as they're recounting this, see these connections, see this connectivity. I mean, this could even been something that Jesus himself referenced to John in Luke 24, where he says, look, this is the Psalms, this is how all these things played out, and he could be connecting these dots for them. So this concludes our kind of second point of using the Psalms in the life of Jesus. We're going to look next at kind of these kingship Psalms. So these are kind of other references to Jesus' life and ministry. All right, church, moving along, we're going to move on to, as I said, the kingship psalm. Some things that prove that that Jesus is from the line of David. Once again, a majority of the psalms written by David himself. And so in Psalm 110:1, it says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." Now, this is a line that's used a lot in the Gospels, and Jesus himself uses it as a stumping ground to the Pharisees of how would David say, "The Lord says to my Lord." No king calls somebody else their Lord, right? Especially a descendant, right? And so this was referenced in Matthew 22:44, Matthew 26:63, and 64. And this is, once again, Matthew 26, when Jesus was before the Sanhedrin pleading or being arrested and tried. It says, "But Jesus remained silent, and the high priest said to him, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to them, you have said so, but I tell you, from now on, you'll see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." All right, so he references Psalm 110 being at the right hand, ultimately making his enemies a footstool. And then this other connection between Son of Man coming to the clouds is a reference from Daniel. And so we see, once again, all of Scripture kind of dovetailing and combining here. Also on Palm Sunday, as the crowds were praising Jesus, he enters into the city of Jerusalem. There was a group of psalms that they would usually sing on their ascent into Jerusalem. Right? Jerusalem is on a mountaintop, and so over time there became this pattern of singing certain hymns or certain psalms as they were going up the mountain. And so Psalm 118 is one of those. So Psalm 118, 26 is, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord." And that's referenced in Matthew 21:9, Matthew 23:39. "And the crowds said and went before him that were following him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Then also in Psalm 118, verse 22, it says, "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone," which is used in Matthew 21:42, Mark 12:10, Luke 20:17, Acts 4:11, 1 Peter 2:7. Once again, all these things are saying that Christ is the King. And that Christ, even this last one, that it was the stone that was rejected has become the cornerstone, right? The thing that most people didn't think had any value, something that they decided to reject, has now become the foundation block, the building block for what was coming before. And we said this seemingly short psalm was then referenced all these other times in reference to Christ himself. And Christ uses this as well to the Pharisees and his rebuke against them. That, look, you're rejecting me, but I am from the beginning of times. I am the King of Kings. I am the King from the line of David. And this also ties then into his divinity, which we'll look at next. So these few things show the kingship, the fact that he is from the line of David. And then next we're going to look at how Christ is from eternity, how he is divine as well, as we look at Psalm 2 next. All right, so we're looking at the Psalms and how they point to the divinity of Christ. And in Psalm 2, I encourage you, if you have some time, read the entire Psalm. We're just going to look at a few verses here. So in Psalm 2:7, it says this, "I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, Thou art my Son, today I have begotten thee." Right? And so this is quoted in Acts 13:33 as a reference to Jesus and his resurrection from the dead. The final part of this verse is also quoted in Hebrews 1:5 as a reference to Jesus with regard to his authority over angels. The final part of this verse is quoted in Hebrews 5:5 as a reference to Jesus being called by God to be the high priest for those who believe in him. Much has been written about Psalm 2 being a coronation hymn for those who were heirs to David's throne, but neither Psalm 2:7 or verse 12 is ever used in the Bible to refer to any son of David other than Jesus, who is more than human descent of David. And this is once again referenced in Matthew 22, verses 41 through 45. And we jump down to Psalm 2, verses 11 and 12, says this: "Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way. When his wrath is kindled but a little, blessed are those who put their trust in him." People were commanded to worship the Son, just as they're commanded to worship the Lord or Yahweh. This agrees with Jesus' statement in John 5:23, that all may honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. And there's a quote from Hebrews 1:8-9, which is a quote from Psalms 45, verses 6 and 7. "But of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions." All right, so this short listing here is, once again, just pointing to this fact that Christ is not only the king, he's not only human, he's also divine, right? This even kind of even ties into the kingship psalms of how would David call one of his own descendants his Lord if he was not something greater than another human being. And so we see this kingship, we see this divinity all connected together here through the psalms. All right, we're going to look next at how the church, especially with Peter and his sermon after Pentecost, then continues on this view of Christ as the Messiah using the Psalms themselves. And so Psalm 16 is quoted by Peter in Pentecost in Acts 2 verses 22 through 36 to point Jews to Jesus as the Messiah. And then he jumps to Psalm 110, which is the most quoted and alluded to Psalm in the New Testament. So just for reference, we're going to read part of Peter's sermon, his testimony, his use of scripture to a Jewish audience to prove that Christ is the Messiah. So let's look at Acts 2, verses 22 through 36. It says this: "Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him," once again, now this is a reference to the Psalms, "I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You have made me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, of that we are all witnesses. Therefore, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of this Holy Spirit, he has poured out this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool.' Let all the house of Israel therefore be certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified," right? So we see Peter referencing these Psalms in connection with the resurrection of Christ to prove that all these things were prophesied, all these things were part of God's plan, all these things were used as a means to get people to see Jesus was the Messiah. Jesus lived, they know he died, and now he's saying, look, he rose again. Even the Psalms say that his soul was not going to go to Hades. His body was not going to see corruption. And so God is honoring these promises, honoring these pledges that he made to David of this descendant who we know now is Jesus. And we see the response to this after Peter declares this to the crowds is that they come to be saved. They ask, well, what then do we need to be saved? And it says, repent and be baptized, right? Peter is using the Psalms, connecting with the life of Christ to see, look, Jesus has fulfilled these promises. Jesus has completed this task. Jesus is the one, the only Messiah. Then I have this quote here as we kind of conclude this morning. It says, the New Testament continually uses the book of Psalms to fix our gaze upon the excellencies of Christ, upon the majesty, beauty, and glory of the one who through his humiliation and exaltation reigns over the nations, leading them to the heavenly Mount Zion, so that lost in wonder, love, and praise, they may proclaim eternally the glory of the triune God. All right, that is my hope as we kind of conclude looking through this. I know we looked at a lot of passages with a lot of references, but my hope is that once again, you could see these connections. You see these uses of the Psalms throughout the ministry of Jesus, throughout the death of Jesus, throughout even the church age, starting off with the sermon at Pentecost, that they're connecting the Psalms to the life of Christ. And so what confidence does this give us? Well, it shows us that God is in control, that throughout hundreds of years through different authors, God is weaving together his story, his plan of salvation for me and for you. And my hope is if you're not a believer in Christ today, that you will be like those Jews in Jerusalem when they see these connections that Peter is making. They realize they need to be saved. The only way to be saved is through Christ alone, through your faith in what God has accomplished for you. And this is all based, once again, on God's amazing plan and that he's in control. Nothing is out of the control of God's hands. That's even what Peter says. Look, all these things, all these events that happen, right? That you crucified, that you led Christ to the cross, that he was ended up being crucified by lawless men, was still all in God's control, all to fulfill these promises and these decrees that God made through David hundreds of years before they actually happened. So God is in control. The next amazing thing is God keeps his promises perfectly. There is not a single promise that God has not fulfilled or will fulfill. And so once again, have confidence that God's in control, that anything he says he will do, he will do. You can take him to the bank. And the final thing is that what does this do? This should hopefully then allow you, once you've placed your faith in Christ, you can rejoice in the salvation that is found in Christ alone. Knowing that you can't earn your salvation, that's a free gift of God through the work of Christ. We obtain it through repentance and faith in what Christ has done. Repentance is acknowledging your sin, acknowledging that you separated yourself from a holy and righteous God because of your sin, and then your faith in not yourself, your faith in the sinless life of Christ, his perfect death, paying the penalty for my sin and for your sin, and then faith that he rose again, that you also can have confidence that you will rise again for all of eternity with God, that Christ has been your substitute. He's stood in place of you, suffering the wrath of God so that you do not have to do that. And so we know if God's in control, we know if God keeps his promises, we know that we can rejoice in our salvation. The promise that God makes that ties all these things together is that Christ is returning, that this isn't the end, that we are on a mission to fulfill the Great Commission, to make disciples of all the nations so that Christ can come back and he can be glorified, he can be praised, and he has saved people from every nation, tribe, and tongue. This should bring us to rejoicing and to be on mission to help people see the amazingness of God's salvation that he alone can provide. So rejoice in this. We're going to close with my favorite hymn, Amazing Grace. All right, church, have a great day.
Was grace that taught to fear and grace my fears relieved. How precious did thy grace appear the hour I first believed. And when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining